Do we have any birthdays or anniversaries?
Before we start, she's turning 15. I turned 24 plus shipping and handling, and as Lisa said, shipping and handling was free.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
A lot of shipping and handling in this. I got to make that.
Take that over there. Don't eat it. Not now.
Don't forget, revival starts on the 6th. This coming Wednesday, 7 o'clock. Thursday, we will have hot dog supper, fellowship hall, starting at 5 o'clock. Anybody that wants to help with it, be here at what time, Pastor? 4:30?
Do we bring food?
Dessert.
Bring dessert. Anybody wants to bring a dessert would be great.
Okay.
Think everything else been taken care of, correct?
Tater chips.
Tater chips.
We could bring tater chips too.
Bring your dessert and tater chips.
Yeah.
And what are you going to have besides hot dogs?
Hot dogs.
we got chili. You can have chili though.
Thank you.
It's hot dog.
Thank you.
Is it homemade chili?
What about
cheese
fries?
October the 29th will be our 5th Sunday night sing. So that's about a month away, but go ahead and start getting prepared.
There won't be any young and hot, right?
Because no young and hot on Tuesday.
Are you supposed to bring something for the meal after the meal?
Yes.
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 Say that. That's Tuesday.
That'll be Tuesday after 4 o'clock, 3 o'clock, somewhere in that neighborhood. Yeah.
Just standing in a hymnal,
this
thing page 390, Power of the Blood.
Bless the Lord.
And you're not going to get used to stop.
That's right. You do right there.
I want
took a walk down that road. I took a job and was to give.
Right.
died for my transgression, that he paid that price a long, long time ago.
Yeah.
But he gave his life for me on a hill called Calvary. But there's something else I wanna know. Does he still feel the nails every time I fail? Can he hear the crowd cry crucify again? Am I causing him pain?
Feel the nails every
house of God.
Just to be here.
She does need three of you men that will help the pallbearers. If any of you come to the funeral and you can help with it, we'd appreciate it. So, Sister Donna, I'm talking about that. I think she's got three in the family that can do it, but she needs three more. So if you are coming to the funeral and you'd be willing to do that, please let me know about your service. It's good to have you, praise God.
Yeah, hallelujah.
Right here.
Turn with me to Matthew, chapter 1, starting at verse 21. We've got several scriptures today. Change up.
Do what?
Matthew chapter 1, verse 21. You want to stick your finger in there and go to Ephesians chapter 2. We can do that. Verse 8 and 10. Verse 10. Matthew chapter 9, we're going to verse 13.
That's too many.
Write it down.
Put this paper in there, brother. Matthew chapter 9, verse 13. That's Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 to 13. I want you to get this today. I want you to have it. Then I'm going to Romans chapter 6, verse 8 through 23. Then I'm done. The Lord says that's enough.
You did Romans
6
what?
8 through 23.
I know. I got it.
Oh, you got enough paper in that Bible to get it.
Yeah.
I got nothing in mine anyway. You know. Everybody got it?
Yeah.
Everybody for it. Praise God. Thank God. I knew y'all could do it. I'm proud of you. Matthew chapter 1, verse 20, that verse 21. We're going to read it in just a minute, but as long as we start off there. I was at a place this week. Somebody was talking, and they said that they were saved in their sin. And it really got me thinking, what do people believe? It really got me thinking, what does the Word say? Because I knew it was wrong whenever I heard it. It was like a light went on the inside of me, and it was saying, this is wrong. And whenever people are saying these things, a lot of times people don't catch it. It's just like part of life. They don't catch it. They think, well, you know, there's nothing wrong with saying it that way. Well, if I say I am in my sins, then my sin continues. But the Word of God says, I am saved from my sins.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Jesus paid a tremendous price on Calvary.
Amen.
That you and I should take a good look at and really see if what He did was worth us being able to say this morning that I don't want anybody to tell me that they're saved in their sins, because they're not. You can't be saved in your sins. Because if you stay in sin, then you're a sinner. You're not a child of the King. Whenever Jesus comes, we are changed. We are a new creature in Christ. We become new. We're not what we were, praise God. We are a new creature. You might say, well, whenever I was thinking about the song, saying, well, you're saying that you don't want to go back to the old way. I don't want to go back to the old way where I have to wash clothes on a ring washer. I don't want to go back to the way where I wash clothes and, I mean, dishes without a dishwasher. I don't want to go back to the old ways where I have to sit with a kerosene lamp. I don't want to go back to the old ways where they have no air conditioning. I don't want to go back to the old way where I got to cut wood to have wood stuff. But praise God, I want to stay in the goodness of God.
Amen.
In the new way and the old way. And there is no new way with God. People are changing God's word to suit themselves.
Mm.
And what I'm trying to tell you this morning, we cannot change God's word to make it what we want it. We have to let it be what it is. Matthew chapter 1, verse 21. Everybody there. And she shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Jesus. For he shall save his people from their sins. It didn't say in their sins, but it said from their sins. Turn with me to Ephesians now. Chapter 2, verse 8 through 10. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Oh, so once I get saved, I'm going to walk in good works. But I've also heard preachers preach, there's nothing to do with works in my salvation. But there are. Because once I get saved, I'm going to walk in good works. I'm going to do the things that God has called me to do. I'm going to obey His word. I'm going to love Him. I'm going to do what He has called me to do. I'm not going to do my own thing, but praise God, I'm going to yield to Him. People say, well, now wait a minute. I don't want to yield to God. I don't want to do what? Then you have to be a sinner. There's only two choices. Serve God or not serve God. There's not another choice. People say, well, I can go over here to this church and they'll say that I don't have to live the way you're talking this morning, and I can do my own thing and I can still go to heaven. But the Word of God will not back that up. And what I'm going to give you this morning, the Word of God will back up. What I'm going to give you this morning is that we are saved from our sins because Jesus Christ paid the sacrifice of His life for you and I. And that's what I want you to get across this morning. If we were saved in our sins, then why would Jesus have to die on an old rugged cross? Because sin would still be more abundantly. And sin has died to the Christian. Once you become a child of God, sin should not enter you anymore. You should strive to not be a sinner, but a Christian, a child of God.
Amen.
And we need to look at this scripture. Let's go back to Matthew chapter 9. Don't get no hurry, everything's going to be all right. Matthew chapter 9, verse 13. But go ye and learn what that meaneth. I will have mercy and not sacrifice, for I am not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. So he didn't come to call the righteous today, Jesus did. He come to call the sinners. You and I have already got our names written down in the Lamb's Book of Life if we're a Christian.
Yeah.
We know where we're going to spend eternity. We know that we need to strive not to sin. We know that we need to walk in His ways and not let the devil deceive us. We need to know that we're walking where God more abundantly has given us grace. Grace came whenever Jesus died on the old rugged cross. Grace became abundantly whenever He went to the tomb and rose in 3 days. He went to the depths of hell. Came out of the depths of hell, and praise God, whenever He did, He had the keys to death, hell, and the grave. And you and I this morning know without a shadow of a doubt that we don't have to die and go to hell because we have those keys to death, hell, and the grave because Jesus died on an old rugged cross. Whenever Brother Billy woke up Tuesday morning, eat his breakfast, and sat down in his chair and then went back into the bedroom, whenever he died, praise God, he didn't have to die anymore because praise God,
Yes.
Lord.
Yep, Jesus.
So
you've got to
We need to think about that.
That's right.
We need to think about that. Turn with me to Romans chapter 6, verse 8. Y'all pray for my breathing. Praise God. I won't be able to preach like I used to preach. I get tired of this not being able to get with it.
Doing pretty good for my house.
Now, if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. So in other words, whenever we come to an altar, repent of our sins, accept Jesus as our personal Savior, we die to this world. And we live with Jesus.
Right.
Knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more, death hath no more dominion over him.
That's right.
So in other words, he were our example. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is our example. And whenever he came to forgive our sins. He came to make peace with his Father and the sin. And he was the only one that was able to do it. So he gave his life at Calvary on an old rugged cross that you and I might have life eternal. That you and I might find the peace that we have with God. And this peace, whenever Jesus died on the old rugged cross, he actually died, but on the third day, he rose again.
Yeah.
And you and I, even though we die to this old world, we are going to rise again.
That's right.
In other words, this body might never rise again. It will rise again. But we'll have a new body.
That's right.
That will meet us up in the air somewhere. And we'll unhook from this old body and we'll have a new body. And that soul that we have inside of us will be in that new body. It'll never wear out. It'll be perfect. Because God created it. Because there'll be no sin to flaw it.
Okay.
I'm painting a picture now. I hope y'all can see my picture. I'm painting it good. I'm trying to paint it deep. I'm trying to get you to see it. Because I am not going to die in my sins. I've already died in my sins. I'm alive. I'm already alive with God. And as long as I choose to put him first in my life, and as long as I say he is my Lord, he is my master, as long as I let him be Lord of my life, then praise God, whenever I die to this old world, heaven's going to be my home.
Amen.
Yeah.
Knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once. But in that he liveth unto God. He lives unto his Father. He died to sin on the old rugged cross for you and I.
Yeah.
He had no sin. He had no sin to have to be forgiven for. I know the world don't understand that, and I know most of the world thinks we're crazy. I know they look at us and they say these are ignorant people. These are people that don't understand. But praise God, whenever I lay down at night and I feel the presence of the Holy Ghost and the power of God overshadow me, then I know there's a God in heaven. I've got something that they don't have. I've got something better to offer God than they've ever had to offer God, because God has given me life eternal, and they don't understand God because they've never really opened their hearts.
That's right.
And let him feast on thee. Because God feasts on us. God feasts on our hearts. God feasts on our love. And I pray to God that you love God this morning. I'm getting no hurry. I've got to plant my seeds. I'm going to water them too this morning.
Awesome.
Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Mm-hmm. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body. That's where this person that says they died in their sins is wrong. Because whenever we died in the altar, we confessed our sins. And we asked Jesus to come into our hearts. And he took those sins away from us, put them in a sea of forgiveness, never to be remembered against us anymore. And praise God, we're not supposed to go back and linger in those sins anymore.
Right.
We're not supposed to go back and pick them up anymore. But what we're supposed to do is walk with God and put him first in our life and have that true relationship with our God.
That's right.
The reason people preach in our sins is because they're living like the devil and they want to cover up where they're going. They know they're going to hell, but they want you to think they're going to heaven. This morning, I want you to know that my name's written down in the Lamb. If I sin, I've got an advocate with the Father, and I ask him to forgive me. Body, that ye should obey it in the lust thereof. Neither ye or your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but ye are unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments unto righteousness unto God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under
grace. Yes.
So I ain't under the law no more.
Nope.
Yeah. I ain't got to go out here and do what the law says I got to do no more. But I'm under grace.
That's right.
But I've got to shun sin, even though I'm under grace, is what it's saying. We have got to shun sin. I am not supposed to sin. I am supposed to walk as close as I possibly can to God. So if you're going up here on Monday morning and you're meeting with your friends, or your friends are meeting with you, and they're cursing and carrying on, and you think that's all right, they go to church on Sunday morning, and they come up here and curse with you on Monday morning, then honey, there's something wrong with their relationship with God. They're on their way to hell, and they don't even realize it. They don't even realize, they don't understand what the plain word of God says, because they're taking it and they're mixing it up by letting the preacher stand before them and say, in your sins, whenever it's from your sins.
That's right.
Yeah. Don't you understand that?
Yeah.
It makes me mad whenever I hear somebody take my word that I got here, that I paid for. You paid for yours and I paid for mine. And they start turning it around to suit themselves.
Bless him, Lord.
So they can cover up their sins. So they can live like the devil, walk like the devil, and not serve God. I'm going to tell you something. I'd rather lose everything I got.
Amen.
Amen.
I'd rather give up everything I got.
Preach it.
And some of you might think, well, I'm just now getting started, and I don't want to give up what little bit I've got started. I'm going to tell you something. You don't have to ever give up anything for God.
That's right.
That God won't give back to you double fold,
right,
better than what you got. Because God's a great God.
Yes, he is.
And he loves you. And we forget that sometimes whenever we're standing and we're looking, we can't see God because we're looking at the big picture and we're saying, I enjoy doing these things. I enjoy doing that thing. I enjoy doing this over here. But I'm going to tell you something. I've never enjoyed any more than having the presence of God overshadow me from the top of my head to the sole of my feet and use me with his glory. I want to tell you something, people. It's time that we look under where our strength is coming from. This whole world's in a mess. Jesus is coming. You might not see it. You might think everything's going good. good. Everything's getting better. But I can tell you right now, what it's setting up for is the mark of the beast.
That's
and
right.
things
yeah.
are coming that people are going to be lost and undone without
right.
this God.
That's
and
right.
they're going to accept it because of men standing
Amen.
In pulpits and trying to tell you that sin's all right. I want to tell you something. I want to be a man that stands up
yeah.
and tell you that sin is in your head and you need to serve this God. Used to be a preacher's pulpit, standing in the pulpit. And he'd tell them the sin they were living in.
That's the Lord.
Now if he tells it, the congregation says, I won't come back. I'll find another church where it'll accept me the way I am. You can find congregations that accept you for whatever you're doing.
Right.
Ever how you're living.
Sure can.
The Mormons say that they can, if the government will don't catch them, that they can have more than one wife. And they're happy with it. The Word of God doesn't say that that's all right.
Nope.
Whenever the New Testament was started, it all became new. Whenever Jesus came, behold, all things were changed.
Mm-hmm.
You can't have all the women you want. And you can only have one if you marry her.
Right.
You ain't married to her, she ain't yours.
That's right.
And you better leave her alone.
Amen.
People says, oh, I take the drugs I want. I enjoy these drugs. Sure you can enjoy it. Next time you get some, and they're laced with something that kills you, and you spend the rest of your life in eternity in hell?
Gosh.
Who are you going to blame that on? You ain't going to blame it on this preacher, because I'm telling you right now, there's been many of people right around here in this neighborhood that's bought the drugs that were laced and they're dead right now.
Amen.
And they're spending eternity in hell. It's time that we wake up and really see, were you saved from your sins? Are you still in your sins?
That's right.
If you're in your sins, you're not saved. You are a
sinner.
You got it, sister. You're lost. You're undone. You're not obeying God. You're lost and you're undone.
Mm.
Used to be that an alcoholic was going to hell. Now, whenever you tell somebody that if you drink, it's wrong, they'll say, well, how much is too much?
First sip.
Well, if you drink an ounce, you're an ounce drunk. You take a sip, you're a sip drunk. So a sip's too much.
Yep.
Because the Bible says no drunkard's going to enter in.
That's what it says.
So we need to be careful. And what we tell people, oh, but Brother Ken, even Billy Graham said one time that a social drink was all right. Well, I'm going to tell you what, if Billy Graham said it, I believe he did. I know he did. Maybe he needed one. But I'm going to tell you what, if he presented that to people, it would cost him his life. Or it might cost him his life. You can't lie to people.
Nope.
Just because you want to be friends with somebody. You can't lie to people. Just because you want to be a part of somebody. Comes to a time in life where you got to say, wrong's wrong and right's right.
That's right.
No matter how much money somebody's sliding you, if you tell somebody else a lie because of it, you're a sinner.
Mm-hmm.
If you're social drinking, you're a social drunk.
That's right.
I'm just telling you the truth.
That's what
I'm trying to set you free because Brother Billy was sitting out over there last Sunday.
Yes, he was.
And if he hadn't known the truth and hadn't lived the way he lived, I don't know where he'd be at today. But he heard the truth and he yielded to the truth.
That's right.
Therefore, sure he's in heaven.
That's right.
I believe that whenever he went to the bedroom and stood in front of his bed and his heart stopped, I believe he went to heaven. Matter of fact, that's my mom's face. She was in there crying about it. I said, he was crying, he ain't frowning. That's like me, pretty happy. So why would he cry? What do you know? Martha and Mary cried whenever Lazarus died. Mm-hmm. And Jesus did too, because he had to bring him back.
Yep.
Because he knew he was in the best place he could ever be. If I die, don't y'all run up here and lay hands on me and try to bring me back.
Amen.
You pray, Lord, if it's your will, you can bring him back. But don't try to bring me back.
Amen.
They wouldn't be signing some papers up at the hospital the last time I was up there. If they could revive me, I said, if I die, leave me alone. I'm going to go to heaven. I don't want to come back. We're at 13?
15.
15. Lord, I'm telling you. What then shall we sin because we are not under the law but under grace? What does that say?
Certainly not.
God forbid.
Mm-hmm.
God forbid. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey his servants, ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death, or of obedience unto righteousness.
Right.
But God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered unto you. Being then made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness. I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh. For as ye have yielded your members servants to uncleanliness and iniquity, unto iniquity, even so now yield your members servants to righteousness, unto
holiness.
That's not denomination, that's holiness. For when ye were the servants of sin, ye were free from
righteousness.
What fruit had ye then in those things, whereof ye are now ashamed, for the end of those things is death. But now be made free from sin and becoming servants to obey to God, ye have your fruit unto holiness and the end everlasting life. For the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. What powerful words.
Mm-hmm.
Powerful words. Say, Brother Ken, why should I have to live a righteous life? Why should I have to shun sin? Jesus gave his life. Took a count of nine, whipped 39 stripes upon his back to the point of death. Then had an old rugged cross pressed upon his back. Had a crown of thorns pressed into his brow. Had to drag that old cross of Golgotha. Fell under the load. Needed help. And whenever we're getting to the top, outstretching those arms and hands, and feet, and kneeling at that old cross, shedding his life's blood on that old cross. giving everything he had to do away with the sin that this world loves so much. Honey, if you've ever served God, if you've ever put Jesus first in your life, today is the day of salvation. Mm-hmm. Today's the day to turn your life around and serve Him. He loves you. He cares for you. He gave it all for you. Hanging on that old cross. Ask for water, get me. Pierce his side. Give up the ghost. And then put in a tomb for 3 days. Come out victorious. With you and me.
That's right.
On his mind.
Amen.
And if he did that for us, it's time that we take our sacrifice back to him. If you're not a Christian,
right,
and lay it at his feet through an altar of prayer.
Mm-hmm.
And say, Lord, save my soul. That I might be what you'd have me to be. Not my will, but thine be done.
That's right.
Put these sins in a sea of forgiveness. Never be remembered against me anymore. What a God. What a Savior. Nobody else would do that for you. Not your dad, not your mom. Not your friend, nobody else. But Jesus did it for you. What an agape love. Unquenchable. Ununderstanding love. Jesus had for you and I. Stand with me. If you're here this morning, God's been speaking to your heart. And no better day than to give your heart to God than today. Brother Billy probably thought he'd be back at church this morning.
Yep.
Rather than in his church this morning, he's up here in a funeral home. You and I, we're planning on coming back to church tonight. We could be up here in a funeral home.
Right.
And if our sins hadn't been forgiven, it won't be heaven or home, but it'd be hell. It's only two choices. There's no in between. I beg you this morning from God's word to step out and come to this altar. Give him what you can give to him, your soul. Let him be Lord of lords, King of kings of your heart. Won't you come? Won't you come as we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, I love you and I praise you this morning, God. Lord, I know there's people here in this congregation, as small as it is, but some of them need to come. Lord, I'm asking you to deal with their hearts one more time. Lord, don't release them, God, but deal with it one more time. Lord, let them see their need of coming and being a part with you. God, I love you and praise you. Lord, I thank you for the message. Thank you for letting me bring this message.
Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
God, if there be one moment that will come to the altar. Once, won't you come? Won't you come? Anyone else? Say. Time in your life, right?
That's right. Have your way, Father God.
might say, well, I can't go back to where I was, Brother Kenneth. I come to the altar. God will work it out. I promise you.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
He worked it out for me. He'll work it out for you.
Father.
Won't you come? Praise God. It's good to have all of you here today. Shake hands and be friendly. You're dismissed.
Amen.